So we've looked now at T2 relaxation and T1 relaxation and how those relaxation rates occur differently within different tissues. And those differing rates account for the T1 or T2 contrast differences within an image. Today we're going to look at how we can manipulate the pulse sequence itself in order to preferentially highlight either the T1 differences in tissues or the T2 differences in tissues. And this is what's known as weighting of an image. We can create a T1 weighted image where the contrast in this image is predominantly due to the T1 relaxation differences between the various tissues. Or we can create a T2 weighted image where the contrast here is because of the T2 relaxation rates that differ within these different tissues. And in the end, we're going to look at a different type of weighting known as proton density weighting. So to review, we know that there are two separate relaxation processes happening simultaneously but independent from one another. The first is transverse decay or T2 relaxation, spin-spin relaxation, where protons are dephasing and we are losing the net transverse magnetization vector. And that loss of net transverse magnetization vector occurs at different rates for different tissues. And it's these differences in rates of loss of transverse magnetization that accounts for the T2 differences within tissues. And we know that loss of 63% of that transverse signal is what's known as the T2 constant. And the T2 constant for each tissue will be different depending on that rate of loss. The second independent but simultaneous process that's occurring is what's known as T1 relaxation, longitudinal recovery or spin lattice relaxation. Here we're getting recovery of the longitudinal magnetization vector, and again, that recovery happens at different rates depending on the tissue we're looking at. And the amount of time it takes to regain 67% of that longitudinal magnetization vector is what's known as the T1 time constant. Now, when we look at these graphs, it can be easy to think that these processes are happening at the same period of time, and this is something that many people get wrong. They think that we have a longitudinal magnetization vector that's happening here in the B0 plane, and we flip that longitudinal magnetization vector 90 degrees into the transverse plane. Many people get confused that the rate of loss of transverse magnetization occurs over the exact same period of time as the rate of gain of longitudinal magnetization. That's not the case. We lose transverse magnetization much quicker than we gain longitudinal magnetization because of those spins dephasing, cancelling out their XY plane vectors and ultimately creating no vector in the transverse plane whilst we're still recovering that longitudinal magnetization vector. You can see here the T2 time for CSF is roughly 160 milliseconds. The T1 time for CSF is 2,200 milliseconds. It takes much longer to regain that longitudinal magnetization vector. So I can't actually fit this into my slide. If these were still to scale, this T2 relaxation would end about here. T2 relaxation happens very quickly when you compare it to T1 or longitudinal recovery. Now we have a basic pulse sequence here with two parameters that we can change, and we've looked at these two parameters, the time of echo and the time of repetition. The time of echo is the amount of time that we wait after the RF pulse to then sample that transverse magnetization signal in the coil in our MRI machine. And we can change this time of echo, and we've seen that changing the time to echo will highlight the T2 differences within tissues. Then we wait a longer period of time while those tissues are gaining longitudinal recovery until we then flip again with our RF pulse. The time between the first RF pulse and the next RF pulse is what's known as the time of repetition. And we've seen that the time of repetition determines the amount of T1 contrast that is going to contribute to our images. So let's review these two processes. We've got time of echo where we're looking at the T2 relaxation within our tissues. We see initially, assuming that all of these tissues have the same number of protons in them, that they all start with maximum transverse magnetization signal. Now this is another point that we have yet to cover on fully. When we apply the B0 pulse to all these tissues, in our example so far, we've assumed that the number of free hydrogen protons that are able to exhibit nuclear magnetic resonance in CSF is the same as what's in muscle. We've assumed that this longitudinal magnetization vector is exactly the same between these two tissues. And it's the magnitude of this longitudinal magnetization vector that will determine the magnitude of the transverse magnetization vector. This vector in the longitudinal plane prior to the 90 degree RF pulse will determine the vector in the transverse plane after the 90 degree RF pulse. Now, in reality, there are more hydrogen, free hydrogen atoms available in CSF and fat than there is in muscle. And when we look at that longitudinal magnetization vector, the muscle longitudinal magnetization vector will be less than the CSF and fat. And when we flip at 90 degrees, we are starting with a lower signal. Now, for our examples, we are assuming that the number of protons available is equal, and we are starting these vectors, these transverse vectors, at the same point here. Now, if we were to select a short time of echo, what kind of contrast would we get in the image? We would get high signal, but we would get very little contrast because all of those transverse magnetization vectors have yet to exhibit T2 relaxation. If we wait slightly longer and measure the sample at a TE with a longer TE, we can see now we've highlighted the differences in transverse relaxation or transverse decay in these tissues. Transverse or T2 relaxation happens much slower in CSF than it does in fat and it does in muscle. We can see that the signal coming from muscle is much less than that of fat, and the signal coming from fat is less than that of CSF. By increasing the TE time, we have highlighted the T2 differences in the tissue. And again, if we wait an even longer time to echo, we then lose contrast as well as losing signal. This is useless to us because we're not getting any signal and we're not getting any contrast. And when we look at the time of repetition, the time we take to allow those spins to start gaining their longitudinal magnetization before flipping them again, we see that that time of repetition change will highlight the T1 differences within the tissues. So we can either choose a short time of repetition or a long time of repetition. So let's see what happens when we have a short time of repetition. We can see that the tissues haven't regained fully their longitudinal magnetization. And if we sample that tissue immediately after the 90 degree RF pulse, we have a short TE here, the differences in these tissues is going to be predominantly because of the T1 differences. If we again look at fat and we look at water and wait only a short period of time before flipping the next 90 degree RF pulse, what exactly happens? Fat regains the longitudinal magnetization much faster than water does or CSF does. So at this TR here, fat has regained much more longitudinal magnetization in the z-axis here than water has. Remember, at this period of time here, we've fully lost our transverse magnetization vector because these spins are out of phase with one another in CSF and in fat. So our actual magnetization vector here won't have any transverse component. We will only have the longitudinal components of these magnetization vectors. So for CSF, it will be around here, and for fat, it will be around here. The degree or the magnitude of that longitudinal magnetization vector in the longitudinal plane prior to this RF pulse here, our TR, is going to determine the magnitude of that transverse magnetization vector. You can see here that water, or CSF, is starting at a much lower transverse magnetization than fat is, and that's because it hasn't regained much longitudinal magnetization here. And that highlights the T1 differences in our tissues. If we wait for a longer TR, you see we wait to regain all of that longitudinal magnetization vector in the various different tissues prior to flipping 90 degrees, we can see that then we lose that T1 contrast. If we sample here at a short TE, we've got no contrast but high signal between the tissues. So let's have a look at an example where we have a long TR and a short TE. We've negated the T1 differences and negated the T2 differences within our tissue. This is the most basic pulse sequence that we can have. A short TE and a long TR with just one 90 degree RF pulse and only one time of echo. What we've created here is a high signal from the longitudinal magnetization vector. We've allowed all the tissues to have a large longitudinal magnetization vector, then flipped them 90 degrees and sampled straight away, not allowing any of the T2 differences to occur within this tissue. If we wanted to take this sequence and create a T1 weighted image, where the contrast in the image is predominantly from the T1 relaxation differences within the tissue, what do we need to do to this pulse sequence? We want to keep the T2 contrast out of the image, so we want to keep the TE time short. So we don't allow any time for those T2 differences to occur, the transverse relaxation to occur. We don't want that to happen, so we keep the TE short. We want to highlight the differences in T1 between the tissues, so we want to reduce this TR time. So look what happens. I'm going to slide this TR time along, and look what happens to the contrast in the tissues, as well as look what happens to this transverse magnetization vector here. We've seen that because those lower TR times don't allow for that full recovery of the longitudinal magnetization vector, they're ultimately going to affect the transverse magnetization vector after that 90 degree RF pulse. So look closely here. As we reduce that TR time, look at the contrast that we've now generated within our image. We know that this contrast isn't due to T2 differences because we've got a very short TE. It's predominantly due to the T1 differences in the tissues here. The differential rates of longitudinal recovery, those differing Z-axis longitudinal magnetization vectors prior to the 90 degree RF flip. That difference now that we're measuring at this TE is because of the T1 differences in tissues. And you can see now that our TR values are much lower than that 2000 value that we were looking at earlier. They're in the 300 to 600 milliseconds. So we've got a short TR and a very short TE in the 10 to 30 milliseconds range. And this is going to create what's known as a T1 weighted image. Here we can see that the CSF is dark, and that's because of this longitudinal magnetization vector having not gained very much vector magnitude here. We've got a lower CSF signal intensity than we do fat intensity. Look how bright the subcutaneous fat is in this image. And we can see we've got intermediate signal from the muscles here. Muscles are lying between the CSF and the fat. And this contrast is based on the T1 differences in our image. So now let's move back to that low T1 contrast, low T2 contrast, but high signal. If we want to bring out the T2 differences within this image, we want to create a T2 weighted image, we want to keep this TR long. We've got high signal and very little T1 differences between the tissues. At a very low TR, there's very little difference in contrast between the T1s, but also extremely low signal here. We can't use very low TR values. We need to use long TR values. Then if we want to highlight the T2 differences, what we need to do is increase that TE time. And as we increase the TE time, we highlight the differences in T2 relaxation, transverse decay within the various different tissues. And we see that T2 relaxation happens much slower in water than it does in fat and it does in muscle. And we created a different pattern of contrast here, which is based on the T2 differences within our tissue. We've kept the TR long at 2000 milliseconds, and we've increased the length of the TE. So we've got a long TR and a long TE. Our TE is now 80 to 140 milliseconds. What we've created here is a T2 weighted image, where the CSF now is bright, the fat has got more intermediate signal, and our muscle has got low signal intensity here. Now you might be wondering, this CSF looks like a fairly low signal. Why is the CSF so bright compared to the fat here? Now this comes back to the fact that the actual number of free hydrogen protons that are available for nuclear magnetic resonance is higher in CSF and fat than it is in other tissues like muscle or connective tissue. So this Y value here in the transverse magnetization plane, we are not accounting for those absolute number of proton differences. So when we wait a long TR period of time here, the fat and CSF will gain a large vector. Our muscle vector here will be smaller, just based purely on the number of protons that are available for nuclear magnetic resonance. And when we flip 90 degrees and wait for those T2 differences to occur, we're going to be starting from different transverse magnetization vectors here. Muscle will actually be much lower, and CSF and fat will be much higher. And that's why we've got brightness here. But it's clear to see here that the CSF is so much brighter in a T2 weighted image, a pure T2 weighted image, than it is in a T1 weighted image. And that's because of the different TE and TR times in our pulse sequence. Now let's go back to this pulse sequence that we keep referring back to, where we've got a long TR, very little T1 differences, and a short TE, very little TE differences. The differences now in contrast in the tissues are going to be purely based on the number of protons that are available for nuclear magnetic resonance. We wait a long time to repetition, and the differences in the longitudinal magnetization vector here will be purely based on the number of hydrogens that are available to exhibit nuclear magnetic resonance. those differences in the longitudinal magnetization vector between the different tissues are purely based on the number of protons. And when we flip it 90 degrees with the RF pulse, those differences in transverse magnetization vectors are going to be purely because of the differences in the number of protons available for nuclear magnetic resonance within that specific voxel. If we sample that tissue straight away, we haven't allowed those T2 differences to occur. And what we've created here is contrast within our image purely based on the proton density within the image. And that's what's created our proton density weighted image. We can see that fat signal is bright. We can see the synovial fluid here, water signal, is also bright. That's because fat and fluid have the highest density of protons available to exhibit nuclear magnetic resonance. We can see that we get great contrast within our image. Again, if we were looking at this T2 relaxation curve, we would think that our muscle signal would be bright. When we look at the muscles in this image, we've got an intermediate signal here. That's because, as I've mentioned now multiple times, this muscle signal doesn't start with such a large transverse magnetization vector because its longitudinal magnetization vector was comparatively small compared to muscle and fat. And when we flipped at 90 degrees, it's starting at a lower y-axis value here on our T2 relaxation curves. And that's why we get an intermediate muscle signal. This red line should actually be lower down on our T2 relaxation curve. You can see that we get excellent contrast in this image. We get very low signal from the menisci, low signal from the ligaments here, as well as the subchondral bone plates. We can see clearly the differences between the bright fluid, bright fat, and those darker structures. And we can see clearly the articular cartilage here. Now later on, when we look at more advanced pulse sequences, we can see how we'll be able to negate the signal from the fat here, only having bright signal coming from water. And that allows us to much more easily identify tears in ligaments or in the menisci here by seeing that contrast between the bright fluid and the surrounding low signal structures. So hopefully I've convinced you now that changing the TR time will highlight the T1 differences in tissues, and changing the TE time will highlight the T2 differences in tissues. And if we have a long TR time and a longer TE time, we are going to get a T2 weighted image. A shorter TR and a short TE time is going to give us a T1 weighted image. A combination of a long TR and a short TE will give us what's known as a proton density weighted image. Now, in terms of remembering the TR and TE values, I haven't seen exams where you are required to remember specific values. What you want is ballpark figures. You'll often be given values and asked to say what type of weighting this image is. Now, when we think of long TR times, we're thinking about 2000 milliseconds. We're in the late thousands to 2000 range. When we think about TE times, we are dealing with the hundreds. Short TE times are in the tens values, 10 to 30, and longer TE times are in the 80 to 160 range. So if you're ever given a TR time that is within the hundreds, 300 to 600, you know that that's a short TR because we're not in the late 1000 to 2000 range. When you're given a TE value that is closer to the hundreds range rather than the tens range, we're dealing with a longer TE. And as long as you can remember those kind of orders of magnitude or scale, you'll be able to identify what kind of weighting you're going to be creating in your image purely based on the TR and TE values. And again, if you're wanting to practice these types of questions, by the time I finish this entire course, there will be a question bank linked in the top line of the description. That's a great place to identify the various knowledge gaps that you have and see where you need to focus your studying on. Now we're going to draw a line at the end of T1 and T2 differences in tissue, and we're going to shift our focus to localizing where exactly signal is coming from within the image. We'll see how we select a specific slice in our MRI and how we plot the signal values based on the X and Y plane within our image. So join me in that next talk where we start to look at spatial localization in MRI images. Until then, goodbye everybody.